Okay, so welcome back. Again, thanks for those of you that could make it. I'm hoping that people start trickling in during the rest of the session. But today I'm going to move on to the second part of the talk, in which I'm going to be talking about more novel stuff. Not that I didn't talk about novel stuff before, because we were talking about methods that haven't been around very long, like using RBMs, for example, for collaborative filtering. But today I'm going to be talking about those things that are probably not that well known, or so those things that people, when we talk about recommendations and personalization, don't immediately think about. And the first topic I'm going to be starting with is, for me, one of the most important ones, which is learning to rank. So if you think about it, the final goal of most recommendations is to produce a ranking, right? And you could think of the recommendation problems as that one of ranking. You have a set of possible items in a collection that you want to present to the user, and you have to come with an ordered list or a ranking of those items. So we already talked about yesterday, popularity is the obvious baseline. And then anything that you can add on top of that, for example, ratings can be thought as a secondary input that you can input to the ranking function in order to make it personalized. And of course, you can add as many features as you want to personalize that ranking. So if we think about, let's have a rating prediction algorithm like the ones we were talking about before related to the Netflix price, and let's rank things by rating. That's an obvious thing you can do, right? You just predict the rating, and then you rank your items from the highest rating to the lowest rating. Actually, that's what we would have done in the Netflix price situation, right? So what happens in this case is that you might end up coming up with rankings like this, in which very niche titles like this anime title, which might be an awesome title, I don't know it, has a very high predicted rating. And this happens many times with very niche titles or titles that have a very sort of devote and strong audience that likes them a lot. And then, of course, all the ratings we have are very positive. So even these two titles might not be very popular, they might come up with a very high predicted rating. And if we rank by rating, we come up with situations like this. On the other hand, if you remember the Netflix price, we were optimizing for the root mean square error. Root mean square error is not a ranking metric. So it's not necessarily a metric we want to optimize when we're optimizing for a ranking, right? So among other things, RMSC is going to weigh exactly the same an error that we make on a high rating than an error we make on a low rating. However, on the low ratings, if we're using for ranking, they're going to come that very down the tail of the ranking and therefore are less important. This is just one example of something that tells you why a metric like RMSC might not be an ideal ranking metric. So whenever I talk about learning to rank or personalize learning to rank, I like to put this picture. I think it illustrates exactly the point of what you want to do. So let's imagine we've been talking about these two concepts, which are popularity and predicted rating. Let's think about coming up with our first learning to rank approach on a two-dimensional space, right? So the idea here is we have two features or two dimensions, which are popularity of the items and the predicted rating. And of course, the predicted rating is the predicted rating for a given user, right? So that's going to be personalized. So we have a set of items here in our collection, and we put them somewhere in the space. So this means, of course, this item is more popular than this one, and this one has a higher predicted rating than this one, right? So the first thing we can try to do is say, hey, let's try to come up with a linear model, because of course, whenever we don't know what to do, it's better to go for a linear model. That's the easiest thing we'll get started with. And that linear model is going to combine the two features that we have, the popularity of the video and the predicted rating of the user and the video, in a linear function. And of course, we're going to have some coefficients here, W1, W2, that are going to be determining the slope of the line in this space, right, of the linear model, this line over here. So we project those items into this linear model, and we produce the final ranking. This seems a very simple idea, and it's very simple, but it's very powerful. This is giving you the initial thought on how to come up with your first personalized learning to rank approach, in which you're using two different features, one that is unpersonalized, which is your popularity, and the other one that is personalized, which is your predicted rating for a given user. Okay? Of course, one thing that I didn't talk about, and that's going to be what I'm going to be talking in the next slides, is how do you learn this model? And if you are going to learn a linear model, you have two parameters here, which are the W1, W2, which is going to be determining the weight that you give to each of the two features in your model. That's the real question here. Is it more important to rank popular items first? Is it more important to give more weight to the predicted rating? And that's something that there's only one way we can answer, and it's with data, right? So we're going to be using the data to fit this model, to fit the model parameters. There's another way you can do it, also with data, but that's going to take a lot more time, which is actually asking your users, right? So that's something that people and companies will do, right? It's like, well, I don't exactly know what to put here, so let me start doing A-B tests and putting different versions of this linear model in front of the users and try to determine what these parameters are by looking what works best. That's a possibility, but it requires time and it's a little bit clumsy. You can do this much better with historical data and optimizing your model and the parameters, fitting them to the data. Any question about this? No? So again, we've come from the idea of predicting a rating and the thought, which was initially in the Netflix prize, like, well, we'll use the rating prediction to produce a final ranking, to say, well, rating by itself is not probably good enough, and we might want to throw in the baseline, which is the popularity, and come up with a two-dimensional model and then fit the model parameters to the data that we have. Okay, so learning to rank is a machine learning problem, and where the goal is to construct a ranking model from training data, a ranking model like the one that I just showed, which was a linear model. And we obviously can produce a ranking model by producing a score, which is a number, and then rank the items according to that score. So that's typical. And one initial way and easiest way to treat the learning to rank problem is to treat it as a supervised classification problem. And actually, I'll talk about that in a second. The other important thing to understand when you're doing a ranking problem is, what is the metric that you want to optimize for? I said before, RMSE is not a good ranking metric. It's not even a ranking metric, right? So we can think about optimizing other metrics like NDCG, mean reciprocal rank, fraction of concordant pairs. Each of these metrics has a different set of properties, and all of them are interesting and good, and you can actually measure your ranking model using all of them. And when I say they have different properties, we usually are interested in how much are they weighting the head of the ranking versus the tail or what kind of decay do they have in the way they weight the errors you make on the head of the ranking versus the ones you have on the tail. And you can think about, of course, making a mistake on the first position, it's huge, right? So you want to make sure that your ranking metric weights more an error on the first position than an error on the 10th position of the ranking. Now, how much more? That's going to be determined by the ranking metric you use, right? So for example, fraction of concordant pairs, FCP, is one, is out of the three, the flattest one. The other two are kind of heavy on the head. OK. If we knew how to, and we will get there, we would want to optimize a machine learning model to directly to one of these metrics. But these metrics are hard to optimize for, and one of the reasons is they're not differentiable. So if you have a method that is going to be using something like gradient descent, you're kind of stuck with something that is not differentiable. We'll find ways of doing it, but initially, it's not obvious how to do it. So what are the different approaches to learning to rank? The first easiest one, I already mentioned it, is to treat it as a regular supervised classification problem. And that's really what's called the point-wise approach to learning to rank, right? So in this case, you basically only need binary judgments on your items, good or bad, right? You just have a class label. And then you use some kind of classification approach. And in theory, you can use any classification approach, as I say here. You're better off if you use a classifier that outputs some sort of probability, like logistic regression. Tree ensembles, like gradient-boosted decision trees, are also very commonly used. SVMs, not so much, because it's not so obvious how to go from the classification of the SVM to the ranking score. But in any case, you can use any classifier as the first approach to a ranker. Any questions to here? Yes.
If you consider personalization, your supervised learning, what is the true order in your training data set?
What is your true order?
Yeah. If you consider personalization, what is the person's true order?
I mean, there is. It's a good question in the sense that you usually when you talk about learning to rank in an unpersonalized fashion when you're doing, for example, search, you construct a ground truth data set, and I think that's what you're referring to, in which you have maybe a panel of experts or people telling you, oh, this is relevant for this query, this is not relevant for this query, right? So in this case, you don't really need such a thing, in the sense that you don't have a query, and the query, you can think about it, is the user, right? So basically, what you're going to be doing is you're going to be constructing a data set in which you have, for this point-wise approach, for example, you're going to have positives and negatives from a given user, and then you're going to have a value for the features in your model, in our case, popularity and predicted rating. And that's it, right? So basically, think about, you know, the matrix of data that you're going to be constructing is basically zeros or ones, whether the user clicked or didn't click on that item, and then the values of the features, which represent the predicted rating for that user, and that's where the personalization comes in, right? So there's not a ground truth data set in the sense that it's equal for everybody. There's a ground truth data set in the sense that you have positives and negatives for each individual user. But those positives and negatives are going to be different for each user, but that's okay, because that's going to be reflected in the fact that the personalized feature, the predicted rating, is going to be different for each user, right? Okay. So moving on from the point-wise approach, we go to pairwise. And pairwise, the idea here is that we're going to be defining the loss function on pairwise preferences. So basically, our goal here is we want to minimize the inversions that we have in our ranking. So we're going to be training models in which we say, well, item A has to be better than item B. And we're going to be optimizing using, again, a binary classification problem, but in this case, optimizing to a pairwise comparison. There are a number of approaches here, and one of them is the ranking version of SVM, Rank SVM, Rank Boost, RankNet, FRank. All of these are pairwise approaches to learning to rank. However, sorry, this is not ultimately what we want to do. Oh, guess the battery died. Sorry. Okay. So that's not ultimately what we want to do. I mean, pairwise is a good step forward, but what we really want to do is to do a list-wise optimization. List-wise meaning we want to have the whole catalog of items, and we want to optimize whatever metric we chose, NDCG, fraction of concordant pairs, for the whole list, right? There are different ways to go about it, and the first way is saying, well, given that optimizing those ranking metrics, as we said before, is tough because they're non-differentiable, let's come up with an indirect loss function, right? So, for example, rank cosine uses the similarity between the ranking list and the ground truth as the loss function. And that's indirectly, obviously, related to some of the ranking functions. Or ListNet uses KL divergence in a similar way. And these methods are okay. The only issue, the only problem is that you're not guaranteed that this indirect loss function that you're optimizing is at the same time optimizing your ranking metric, right? But again, it's difficult to optimize directly the other metrics. Okay. So how can we directly optimize those? When I say IR, I mean those ranking measures. So there are actually some smart papers out there which do, by the way, all of these are going to be in the references at the end of the slides. They do things like using genetic programming or simulated annealing to just like almost do a brute force approach to optimizing those ranking metrics. And more recently, there's been other approaches that are going around the problem in a different way. And one of them is trying to come up with a smooth version of the objective function. And there's a couple of papers starting in 2012. They're actually by the same authors, and they've come up with different ways to smooth different versions of CLIMF or CLIMF. That was optimizing for mean reciprocal rank. And then TFMAP was optimizing for mean average precision, which is another ranking metric. So they've come up with definitions, smooth definitions, so smooth meaning differentiable definitions of the ranking metrics, and then added them to different methods like matrix factorization. In a similar way, SVMMAP does a similar thing and relaxes some of the constraints of the mean average precision metric, and for this particular metric, add them to the SVM constraints. And AdaRank uses boosting to optimize NDCG, right? So here, in this last method, you basically have to be a little bit smarter about how to optimize for one particular metric, how to either relax it, smooth it, or add it to the constraints of the method that you're optimizing for. But it's possible to do. And again, this would be, in some sense, the preferred way, because here you're, on the one hand, optimizing for your whole list. On the other hand, you're optimizing for the metric that you want to optimize. OK. There's another one I forgot to add here. There's an interesting one was presented in KDD last year, which is called Direct Rank, which I would also recommend if you're interested in list-wise approaches. And what else? I think all of the others I already mentioned. So any question about this idea of learning to rank? And again, remember back to how I started with this two-dimensional space, popularity and predicted rating, and this linear model, which we needed to estimate the weights, and we do that by fitting the parameters to some of the data, and in order to fit them to the data, we need to figure out how to do that. We can go from the easiest approach, which is use a classifier, which is the point-wise, to more advanced methods like pairwise or listwise approaches to learning to rank. Okay. And now we've added a step forward from where we were yesterday, where all, quote unquote, all we were doing is predicting the rating using some of those methods. Now we've done a second step. We've predicted the rating, and we've added another feature, which is the popularity, and we've optimized a ranking model to it. Okay? Yes?
Is there any ranking method that works better than the other ones? Or, I mean, if I were to build a system, which one should I try at all?
Yeah, I mean, it's a fair question. I don't have a good answer for you because it's really dependent on the kind of data that you have. Many things related to the distribution of your data, and not only your data points or your labels, but actually your feature space, right? This is like, if you ask me, what's the best classifier? Well, it depends, right? It depends on dimensionality of your feature space, it depends on the kind of features you have and their distribution and many other things, right? What I would say, what I always say, is start with the simplest and only make things complicated if they're really worth it, right? So the idea, some of these methods are interesting and fun, but they're very costly, right? Think about simulated annealing and so on, right? So if you're really going down that path, you really need to make sure that you're getting something out of it, right? Okay. So in the next part, I'm going to be talking about context-aware recommendations. Now, we're moving a step beyond in our quest for more dimensions, right? We started with having a prediction problem, which was the rating. We added popularity, and we turned it into a two-dimensional, or by the way, n-dimensional, right? Because I said we added two features, but you can think about adding absolutely any features into your learning to rank approach, including content-based features. So you can use it as a method to hybridize and add different things, right? But now we're going beyond that, and we're going to be throwing in context into the equation. So what I think it's pretty obvious that context is going to be, or it's an important part of a recommendation or a personalization. The idea here is that the user, depending on outside conditions like the location, the weather, or the time, is going to have different preferences, and those are going to influence whatever we want to recommend. We usually talk about three different kinds of context-aware recommendations: pre-filtering, post-filtering, and contextual modeling. And pre-filtering and post-filtering are pretty simple. This is illustrated here in this diagram. So in pre-filtering, basically you add your context as a filter to your input data, then you build your recommendation model, and you continue as if it was a regular two-dimensional recommendation problem. In contextual post-filtering, you do it the other way around. So you build your model and you operate on all your data that includes all the context. And then when you're going to do the recommendation at the end, you do the filtering step and you remove those things that don't make sense for a given context. So the idea here is basically you build your recommendation on everything, and then you say, well, if it's midnight, now all these other things that seem to be more appropriate for morning, I'll just remove them, or I'll re-rank them using that feature. Those two are okay, and I think they're pretty obvious. The most interesting one is, how do we do contextual modeling, right? So how do we throw in context into the model itself? And that's basically what I'm going to skip through this, because again, it's pretty obvious how you do pre-filtering and post-filtering. And I'm going to go basically directly to the contextual modeling. So in contextual modeling, what we want to do is use the contextual information directly on the model. And the obvious challenge here is that now what has traditionally been a two-dimensional problem, where we have users and items, becomes a multidimensional problem. Now we have users, items, and time of the day, or day of the week, or weather, or location. And those are all dimensions that we add to our multidimensional problem, right? So we can have things like user, movie, which are the two dimensions, and then time, company, place, and so on. So this two-dimensional problem we have has now become an n-dimensional problem. There's an obvious side effect of this, which is, if we were worried about sparsity before, now we have an even worse problem, right? Because we had sparsity on this two-dimensional problem, but now if we add more dimensions, we're going to be even having more sparsity, because we had few users rating a given movie, let alone users rating a given movie in a particular day of the week, in a particular location, right, and with a particular weather. That's going to be very, very sparse. Okay, so how do we deal with this? And there are different ways. I'm going to talk about two of them. One of them is actually comes from a paper that I published on tensor factorization, and the other one is going to be factorization machines. So one of the clear and obvious things that we need to do is we need to reduce the dimensionality of our problem. It's very hard. There's no way that we can address this problem directly with the kind of sparsity and dimensionality that we have, right? So one thing we can think about is, well, let's try to factorize, just as we did with matrix factorization. And this leads us to the idea of tensor factorization. So in the case of matrix factorization, we had a two-dimensional matrix that we wanted to represent as the combination of two different matrices, the user factors and the item factors, and we had the diagonal matrix in the middle. Now what we have is this, which is a tensor, right? And I'm going to be representing always the tensor as a three-dimensional, so as a cube, but this is really not a cube, right? This is an n-dimensional tensor with context being many different dimensions. So what we want to do is something like this. So we want to decompose, and this is what's called the higher order singular value decomposition. So we want to decompose this cube into a number of different two-dimensional matrices, and one of them is going to be the item matrix that we have before, the user matrix, and we have another one here, which is the context. And then we're going to have a tensor here in the middle, which is going to have the dimensionality of the three other matrices. And this is the basic idea, same idea as we did before with matrix factorization, but extrapolated to the idea of tensors and n-dimensions. So So here I'm going to introduce some notation that I think should be probably, or I thought that it could be well known because you already talked about matrix factorization again with Deepak. I know I skipped through most of this yesterday when I was talking about matrix factorization. Then when I was talking after the class with some of you, I wasn't sure it was clear. But the basic idea is that when you're, even in the two-dimensional problem, when you are trying to find or to estimate these matrices, or in the case of the two-dimensional problem, the user and the item matrix, you formulate this as a traditional sort of like regression problem where you're going to have a loss function and some regularization, right? And the key issue here in the tensor factorization case is that you have a loss function here, and then you're adding two regularizations, and the two regularizations, one of them is on the things that you really care, which are the three matrices, the M, the U, and the C, and another one on the central tensor, which is the S. And basically, this is going to be a convex function that you are going to optimize using some gradient descent technique or any other method. But the idea is, what do you put here? What is your loss function, and what is your regularization? And this is really the same thing as what you would do in the matrix factorization case, right? When you are estimating the matrix factorization and the quote-unquote SVD, you're not really computing the closed form SVD. You're doing something like this. You're also having a loss function and some regularization, and you're using some iterative optimization method to optimize this function for a given metric. So in our case, the regularization regularization that we're going to be using is an L2 regularization, both for the S and for the F. Here is this one here, right? So it's an L2 regularization for both the F, which includes the three matrices that we care about, the M, the U, and the C, and for the S. And for the loss function, we can do different things, but what we did in this paper is we use a simple square error loss function. So basically, we're optimizing the loss function, which is the 1/2 of the F minus the value that we have the data square. So the idea here is you have some data points, you're optimizing to the error between the F and you're computing the F, just as we were doing yesterday when I was saying how do you compute the ratings given a matrix factorization approach. So basically, this is going to be the dot product of the user and the item. In this case, we have the context also, but it's the same. And you subtract the data point that you have, you square. This is going to be your loss function. You add your regularization terms here, and you optimize from there. So basically, the loss over all users and all items is going to be just the sum of the loss of each of the items that you have. Any questions?
Your number of regularization parameters, it grows linearly with dimensionality, right?
Yeah.
How do you tune them? Do they have a special procedure?
It's a good question. And in this particular case, the only way you have to tune them is to basically, as you usually tune hyperparameters, doing a hyperparameter search on your space. And if you have many dimensions, that's going to be costly. You have ways of, and we'll get to there when I talk about factorization machines, of using other approaches like MCMC, where you can minimize the number of hyperparameters. But in this case, you will have to determine your regularization parameters for all the dimensions you keep adding in your context. Yeah. But I mean, this is it's a typical limitation on any method that you add some dimension that you need to come up with a hyperparameter for, right? Okay, so you could also use the absolute error loss function. We use the square one, and you basically, well, this is how you derive the partial gradients with respect to each of the matrices that you have. So this is not, and then you actually have yet another hyperparameter, which is the learning rate that you need to determine here. And well, not to mention you even have another one that I didn't mention, but that's typical in matrix factorization, which is the number of latent factors that you want to use, right? But that's usually doesn't change so much, interestingly. Okay, so I'm gonna show you some results now. But is there any question on how tensor factorization works? So it's really the same idea as in matrix factorization, but extrapolating that to an n-dimensional space. So in this case, we were computing the mean average error. We use three different data sets. There's not so many data sets out there that add context to it, right? So it's not as easy. You can't really do this on the Netflix data set because you don't have a context to add. But there's some here that do have, like the Yahoo or the Food. They have two dimensionals, and the Adama Vicious one has five dimensions. But they're very small in this case. Okay, and we compare to a couple of different methods. Now, I think the key point what I want to show here, the reason I added this slide, is we did find that the mean average error when we were using context in all our data sets was lower, right? And that's a pretty strong and key finding, right? It's like, really, if you have context and you can use it, you are going to get better results. And I think that's, for me, one of the sort of like highlights and why I wanted to show this. The idea is, it's not obvious, right? Because again, if you're using the context, you are adding sparsity, so it could end up being worse. But it turns out that using this approach, if you use context, you have a significant reduction in the error. So you are improving things. And now, yeah, this one is not so important. This is comparing to other context-aware methods like pre-filtering and so on. And it shows that it's also better. But I think the key issue is that it's good to use the context if you have it. Okay, I'm going to skip through all these slides, but the idea here, key idea that I wanted to show is this one, right? If you don't use context, you're much worse off than if you do use context. And most of the other methods do the same thing. They work better than context. And our approach using tensor factorization worked even better than the ones that were out there in the literature. Okay, so this conclusion here is going to lead me to the next topic. So context matters. Tensor factorization offers an easy way. Oh, yeah.
Sorry, before you go to the next topic, have you compared with other methods of tensor factorization? Because there are more types of tensor factorization, like the one that keeps orthogonal factors, for example. Would there be any benefit of using other?
So this paper came out 6 years ago, I think. So at that time, it was the only tensor factorization approach that at least was had been applied to this particular application. So we didn't compare to any other tensor factorization approach. I don't have an answer for that. My answer would be this one here, which is there might be some better tensor factorization approaches, but if I had to bet, I would say, well, why not go for factorization machines, which I think in the general case, I would say they probably beat the tensor factorization approaches in most practical applications. But there could be other tensor factorization approach where you can beat the what we were doing. I think the interesting thing about tensor factorization, though, is that it's a framework that is very similar to the matrix factorization one, and it's easy to understand. If you understand matrix factorization, you understand tensor factorization, and the way you optimize it, it's very similar. Okay, so factorization machines. So factorization machines were introduced by Stefan Rendel in 2010. And I know we have a student from Stefan Rendel, right? There he is. So Stefan was at university in Germany. What was the university?
Constant,
yeah. And now he's at Google. And factorization machines became kind of popular. I mean, they did become popular in a small community, but they became popular not only because of the papers, but also because Stefan used them in a couple of the Kaggle competitions, and he won one of them, and he was second in a couple, and it was kind of like known in the community that, hey, this guy on his own and using a method that seems a little bit exotic managed to beat a bunch of other people. So obviously, I don't have time. It would take me like an hour to go into the details of factorization machines, but I thought it was important to highlight their usage as a novel method. And I put them in this part of the contextual recommendations because they can be used as a way to do contextual recommendations, but not necessarily. They can be used in the general framework of recommendations without having context. So the basic idea and the way that Stefan explained this is we need, or we would like to have a generalization of regularized matrix or tensor factorization that we would be able to combine with the traditional regression or machine learning approach, right? Because the problem is every time we need to think about a new dimensionality or a new problem that requires of a new dimension to add to our problem, we need to come up with a new learning algorithm. And I kind of simplified things in the case of the tensor factorization approach, and I was using discrete variables. But what if you have continuous variables, and what if you have different kinds of variables? And that kind of gets things a little bit messy, and you need to think about how to optimize for each time you add something new to your problem. Wouldn't it be nice if we had an approach like regression, where you basically throw in features and you optimize, you have your regularization, and you don't need to worry so much about the model, because the model is always the same, is a regression, and all you need to do is throw in different features. So we would like to combine both things, the power of sort of standard regression and the power of factorizing, because we don't want to do a regression on the original dimensionality of the problem because it's usually huge and sparse, and we want to be able to reduce dimensionality at the same time that we do our regression. So what we are going to do is treat the input as a real valued feature vector. And then we're going to model linear and pairwise interactions between variables of whatever number of features that we have. So basically the idea here is, and that's the easiest way to understand, we're going to build a polynomial regression, right? So this is not going to be a linear regression. It's going to be a polynomial regression where we're going to have all the possible different interactions between the k features, right? I'll show the formula in a minute. Now, of course, that doesn't work. I mean, you know, polynomial regression doesn't work for a simple reason. It's because you don't have enough data to fit all the parameters that you have in your model to all the different interactions that your features are going to have. So, and that's when factorization comes in, what we need to do is reduce the dimensionality of the space. And how do we do that? Well, using the traditional matrix factorization approach. So we're going to do a polynomial regression, and we're going to factorize the interactions between the features in order to reduce the dimensionality of the problem. And that's the key idea of factorization machines. Polynomial regression in which we factorize the interaction between variables in order to reduce the problem. And in this way, we combine both things, right? The generality of machine learning or regression with the quality of factorization models, especially in high-dimensional sparse problems. So this is how it looks like. So if we have, for a number of features that we're going to have D features, right? These are going to be, if we had only this thing here, we would be combining them in a linear regression. But we're adding this term here, which we are adding all the possible interactions between the different features, right? So here we're going to have the XY, XJ feature. And then the key thing here is that we're going to factorize their interaction. So instead of having one single weight for each of these pairs of interactions, we're going to be factorizing this term. And basically, we're going to be optimizing for this other function here where we're minimizing for the error between these two. And we're reducing the order of the problem from a D-square problem where we would have all the different pairs of variables interacting to an order k times d, where d is the original dimensionality, the number of variables that we have, and k is the factors that we decide to factorize to. Okay? So here, we're summing this from 1 to k, and we're optimizing this term over here. So basically, think about this as a matrix factorization of k dimensions over the interactions between the different variables, different d variables that we have. Okay? So now, the interesting thing about this approach and the way that sort of Stefan likes to sell the model is that it's really a generalization over any of the other models that are known, including matrix factorization, tensor factorization, and so on, right? Because depending on how you model your feature space and you apply it to the definition of factorization machines, you're going to come up exactly with the definition of this subclass of problems, right? So basically, if you only have two categorical variables, you and I, right? So this is user and item. And you encode them like this with an indicator variable where you have the user, right? So this is basically for user one, these are the movies that the user one watched, right? So you encode it like this, and you apply the factorization machine formula, you basically come up with the conclusion that this is exactly the same thing as you would do in a matrix factorization, this is a matrix factorization term, plus the biases. And the biases, as we, I mean, as we saw when I was talking about SVD++, we also apply them when we're doing a regular matrix factorization approach, right? So you have, this is basically, this basically becomes the traditional matrix factorization approach. If you add, but you can add very simply another term here, which is going to be time, right? So now we have two categorical variables, the user and the item, and we have a continuous variable here, which is time. I don't remember how it was so exactly how it was converted. I think it was from 0 to 1, meaning 0 meaning midnight, and 1 meaning the next day, right? The 12 p.m. So 12 a.m. Sorry. So basically, but it doesn't matter. The thing is, if you want to add a contextual variable that is continuous, you just plug it in to your model. You add it here like another variable, and you come up with an equivalent equation, which turned out to be one way that in another paper they were trying to do contextual recommendations using time in a continuous manner, right? And in the same way, you can derive from factorization machines the same approach that you could do with tensor factorizations and so on. So you could see even the approach that I was mentioning before in tensor factorizations as a subclass of problems that you can address with factorization machines. Because at the end, it all comes down to building a regression with different terms, and those terms come from the way that you define your problem and you plug it in as you would in a regular regression problem. So there's different papers and different ways to train the factorization machines. So initially, the first papers that Stefan published, he was using stochastic gradient descent, or ALS. And one of the problems there is the number of hyperparameters and how do you tune those hyperparameters. That became kind of tricky, right? Because although all the other things are easy to encode into your problem as a regularization, you need to come up with a way to optimize all those hyperparameters, and it's not easy. So basically, he later introduced a way to do MCMC with Gibbs sampling and reduce the number of hyperparameters. And I know for a fact that that's the preferred approach now, to use MCMC for training the factorization machines. And in this case, you can avoid a number of hyperparameters. So, by the way, the learning parameters that you have if you don't use MCMC are the number of factors, which is, as always, the number of iterations, the initialization scale, the regularization, if you do SGD and ALS, and you have multiple regularization parameters, just as you did with tensor factorization, and the step size, right? So you have to, you have a hyperparameter search space, which is can be pretty big. But if you use MCMC, you remove the need to set all of these hyperparameters. Okay. So any questions about in general context-aware and tensor factorization and factorization machines? I of course, because I'm giving sort of like a very broad overview of all these different methods, and I'm not going deeply into any of them, but I think I'm giving you some interesting pointers of things that if you're interested in any of these topics, you should definitely go and read more about them. There are a bunch of papers on factorization machines, and there's a tutorial in KDD, I think, in 2012, that Stefan did, where you can also find a long version of what I just explained about factorization machines. And he also talked about tensor factorization in that tutorial. Okay, so other novel approaches, deep learning. I know you had Nando here, right, the first week talking about deep learning, and everybody's talking about deep learning, so I need to talk about deep learning. And we use deep learning in recommendations. It's pretty new, and there are not many examples, and not many public examples. So what I'm going to be describing here are the only two public examples that I know of using deep learning or new generation neural networks for recommendations. One of them is by the guys at Spotify. I already mentioned Eric yesterday, and he actually published this 2 weeks ago in a blog post, so I got it from him. The other one is about us and Netflix using a different approach, an approach that I can't say too much about, unfortunately, so I'm just going to be glossing over what we do in the infrastructure side. But I'll give you some interesting ideas of how you can use this new generation neural net and deep learning in recommendations. Okay, so this is the post that I was referring to. So Eric posted a couple of weeks ago how they're using recurrent networks for playlist prediction. And playlist prediction is a very important problem for music. Think about Pandora. That's all they do. That's their business, right? And Spotify have a similar model where basically the idea is it's important to predict the sequence of the things you're going to be listening to, right? It's not only about this is one recommendation problem that is different from the ranking problem, right? This is not about giving you a list of ranked things and you choose the top ones. This is about giving you a sequence of things to do. And if you're listening to this thing, what should be the next one? By the way, we also have that recommendation problem on the movie space, but it's not so obvious. So anyway, they thought about this idea, or he thought about this idea of modeling this as a recurrent neural net problem where you basically see the sequence of your observations here, which is the things that you're observing, and you have some hiddens, and you have relations between your hidden and your visibles and between the hiddens themselves. And this can be modeled as a recurrent neural net. So there are a number of assumptions that they make in order to make this feasible to compute, and those assumptions are not necessarily, I mean, you don't need to believe them from the get-go, right? Because the assumption of the normal distribution, it's like, okay. But it turns out that according to what they're saying, the final model worked and worked pretty well. So it means that those assumptions were okay to start with. So the assumption is that the probability of one of the visibles given the hidden is a normal distribution, and then the log likelihood, and therefore the log likelihood of the loss is just the L2 loss, right? The negative of the square of the difference. And then they also go into specifying the activation function of the hidden, and it's going to be a function of the, obviously, of the activation of the hidden I plus one is going to be a function of the previous hidden and the previous visible. And the model is completely specified, and you have 3k square parameters. So basically what you need to do is to find the U and the V that you have here in this activation function, and the W, which are the weights, that maximize the log likelihood over all the examples. And you can do that using backpropagation as you would do to optimize any neural net, basically by optimizing the log likelihood over all the examples using the square loss. So that's the training part. And then in order to do the prediction, they choose the probability of the visible given the hidden using, well, first they use softmax for this distribution, which leads you to this formula for the probability of the visible given the hidden. And there's a basic problem which has already been solved in the literature with this, which is that this is the denominator here, which is over all the examples that you have, it's a very expensive thing to solve. And it would be unpractical to do a prediction using this particular formula. And the solution, which there's some more details on the blog post, is that you can build a tree structure that implements a hierarchical softmax that basically does an evaluation of this, of all the softmax formulation in a way that becomes practical and becomes usable in a real system. So again, the idea here is building a recurrent network over your visibles, which is the songs that you listen one after the other, and assuming there is some relation between the hiddens, and modeling this using an L2 loss and the softmax for the probability of a visible given the hidden. And this is, I thought it was an interesting example, simple example of using sort of recurrent neural network. When I was reading it, I was thinking that it was so simple that it was surprising that it worked, but it seems to work. And in talking to Eric, it does seem like it's working pretty well. So this is yet another example of how applying one of these unsupervised deep learning approaches can lead you to good results. So, okay, I think that's it about the application of deep learning in the music case. In our case, again, I can't give many details of how we're using. We're using a very different model, by the way, because we're not interested here in modeling the sequence of anything, but we're basically building it as a, say, quote unquote, standard recommendation approach. And the one of the reasons you can see that we are doing this in a different way is the setup that we are describing. So basically, this is another blog post. I published it like 2 or 3 months ago. And we describe the details of the infrastructure. So we don't say what kind of neural networks we're using or in what details for what, but we are saying how we have implemented it. So I think it's an interesting complement to what I was saying before, which is the other way around. So the idea here is for some of the, say, normal applications of deep learning, one of the problems you have is that you have a lot of hyperparameters to tune. And they're not, those neural networks are not easy to train. And how do you combine the training and the optimization of each of the neural nets plus the search on the hyperparameter space, right? And this is what we're doing, and what I described there is how to combine the training of the neural net and the search on the hyperparameter space. So the training of a single multi-layer neural net is kind of, I was going to say has been solved. I'm not saying it has been solved, but it's pretty obvious that you want to do it on a multi-core GPU machine, right? You want to optimize or minimize the out-of-box communication, and there's many examples out there from Google to others that have done a very good job of implementing deep learning and neural net training on GPUs. And that's exactly what we did, right? So we basically used GPUs to train each of the neural nets. Now the interesting thing is that, well, yes, but once you've trained one neural network and one GPU, and you want to train another one, or you're training another one in parallel, is how do you figure out which one was the best one? How do you optimize your hyperparameters to understand which is the neural network that you really want to use, right? So the basic idea is you have a bunch of independent neural nets that you throw out there to GPUs, you train them with different hyperparameters, and then you use the best ones, but you need a way to coordinate all of that, right? So the way we did this is we have a central node where we're using this has already changed, by the way, but basically the idea is the same. We're using Spearmint. So Spearmint is an implementation of Bayesian hyperparameter optimization using Gaussian priors. It's a package that you can download. It's in Python, and it's there are a couple more that are comparable, but Spearmint is good enough for what we're doing. I don't know if anybody has talked about Gaussian processes here. I think, you've talked about it, right? So the idea is instead of doing an exhaustive search in the hyperparameter space, you're better off doing something smarter, and using Gaussian processes is a good way to get started. So we have this central machine where we do the hyperparameter search using Gaussian processes, and we launch, once we iterate and we have a number of hyperparameters or subset of hyperparameters, we launch a different machine, and this is all done in the cloud, by the way, in AWS Amazon Cloud. So we launch a different machine with GPUs, and we train that network. It comes back to the central node, and this is the sort of like the brain in charge of doing the different hyperparameter optimization steps. So this is how we combine, on the one hand, the power of training on the GPUs for each of the neural networks and the distributed and environment on the cloud to do the hyperparameter tuning. Okay, so obviously this is a different implementation than the one I was talking about, because here we do have hyperparameters to tune, and here we do have a lot of neural networks that we're optimizing at the same time. Any question about this? Yeah.
Are you using methods like Dropout?
Sorry, I didn't hear.
Are you using methods like Dropout?
Like Dropout?
Yeah.
No. And I mean, there's a number of optimizations that we could do to the current setup, but the reality is that as it is right now is optimal enough that it's even more efficient than other traditional methods that we could be using, right? And by the way, this is something that you don't necessarily need to do extremely fast, right? So you can do the training every few hours, so to speak, and this is going to work. Okay, so yeah, and this brings me to something that I've talked about a couple of times, and it's what when you think about distributing machine learning or parallelizing machine learning, people usually talk about how to parallelize or distribute like a single particular algorithm, right? And that would be like, for example, the training of a single neural network. And that's what I call the level three. Level three distribution or parallelization, it's good and it's an interesting thing. But in this case, we really can do it using highly optimized CUDA code on, you know, multi-core GPUs. And that's really not our main concern. Our main concern is how to distribute on two other levels. And on the highest level, and that's something I didn't mention before, but usually when you have a large-scale system like Netflix would or Google would, you're going to have to optimize your models with a different set of hyperparameters for a different region, right? So you can think about if you have a ranking model that is working in the US and another one that is working in Brazil and another one that's working in UK, those are going to be tuned differently. And you need to be constantly retraining using the data that you get on those particular regions. And that's the easiest of all distributions, because basically what you do is they're completely independent. You can communicate data if you will, if you want to share some of the data, but not necessarily. Then the second level of distribution is the one that I was describing before, is when you're optimizing the hyperparameters, and that requires coordination, because that requires launching different machines, optimizing different subset of the hyperparameters with a given algorithm, and then coming back and saying, okay, this was the best one. And then finally the level three, which is the algorithm itself, how is it distributed or parallelized, right? And this is something that I usually see, especially in academia, a lot of people talking about this, but not too many talking about the other two. Yeah?
This training would require the whole complete data set to be stored in GPU memory, right?
Yeah.
Is it a problem?
It could be a problem. In our case, it's we make it in such a way that it's not a problem. So you can make it part of your process in a way that, you know, you get sufficient data to train all the parameters you have, and you don't need to distribute this part over here. Okay, we'll have a little bit over half an hour, and I think I'm gonna probably get almost done with many of the things that I left, because these two are a little bit shorter. So I've talked about similarity a couple of times already, and in the context of recommendations. But in this case, what I want to bring up is a different idea, and it's the idea that in some cases we might want to recommend things that are similar for a given definition of similarity. So the idea here is that our objective function now, instead of becoming what is it that I think it's going to be best for the user, and I'm going to be ranking on the data that I have from the user on what the user likes the most. Here, what I'm going to be using is the idea of similar. And this could be something that I use, for example, in the context of I just finished watching a TV show, and I want to recommend something that is similar to the TV show that the user has been watching, just so that person can continue watching something that is related to what was just watched, right? And this is a little bit related to the prediction of the playlist that we were talking about in the songs, right? So it's not only about finding something that the user likes, it's about finding something that is similar to the previous thing the user was watching. So when we talk about similarity in the context of recommendations, first thing to keep in mind is that similarity can be defined along many dimensions. So similarity doesn't really necessarily need to mean that those items are similar in terms of content, which was the content-based approach that we talked about yesterday, right? It doesn't necessarily mean the two movies or two books are going to be similar because they have approximately the same context. That could be an interesting input to the similarity function, but not necessarily the only one, right? So basically, you can have similarity in metadata or tags or content, but you can also have similarity in play behavior. And we talked about that when we were talking about the item-based collaborative filtering. You can have similarity in rating behavior. You can say, hey, I'm going to decide that two items are similar if users rate them similarly, and so on and so forth. So basically, you can have as many definitions of similarity as you want, and they're all perfectly valid, and you can learn models for each one of them. And what's more, you can learn an ensemble that combines all of them. And here, the interesting thing is that you can tune and optimize your ensemble to the data that you have, right? So in whatever context you want to present the similarity to the user, you can start with the definition of different concepts of similarity and then tune your ensemble to the data that tells you whether the user react more positively to one similarity or the other. So it's basically a similar idea to the one that I was describing in when we're doing the two-dimensional ranking problem, and we had rating prediction and we had popularity, and I said, well, I don't know whether the users want more popularity or more rating prediction, but I can do that easily if I have data, and then I tune my model and I find the weights depending on the data that I have. Here is the same thing. So basically, I'm going to have three or n definitions of similarity. I'm going to put them in an ensemble and then learn the weights depending on the data that I have. In the context of similarity, one important idea and something that works and has been described in the literature many, many times is the idea of graph-based similarities, right? So given whatever sort of metric that can become a similarity metric, and here I can say, well, I don't know, I can use the cosine similarity between the TF-IDF if they're textual documents, right? I can define a graph, which can be directional or not, in which, and in this case, I'm drawing it directionally, meaning that the similarity from fighter to madman is 0.8, but from madman to fighter is 0.3. So you can do that. Obviously, it depends on the kind of data and the kind of way you define your metric of similarity. But the basic idea is that you can construct a graph like this, and then you can apply graph-based techniques to find what are the steady-state transition probabilities, or what is the similarity between movies that are not even connected directly. There's been, as I said, a number of works that explain how to do this. I would recommend, if you want to start somewhere, this is a good paper, SimRank in 2012. And the idea is that two objects are similar if they're referenced by similar objects. And the concept here of similarity and the reason it's called SimRank, it's basically a page rank for similarity. But the other interesting thing that they describe in this paper is how to combine these different notions of similarity. So the idea I was saying you can optimize an ensemble for, here you can do it in the same graph, because the kinds of relations that they were defining in the graph, they were dependent so the axis could be depending on a given context or a different one. So they were using citation papers, papers, and they were describing the co-occurrence of papers given a venue, given co-authors, given a topic, and they were finding similarities based on all these different axes were being described in the graph. So this is a good, interesting first approach. It's something that similar things like this are being used as a way to compute a notion of similarity. And again, this is a step beyond what we were saying before, and what we were saying, or I was saying yesterday, where I kind of simplify the notion of similarity and say, well, in the case of content-based similarity, is the cosine similarity, or it's basically just the difference between tags. And in the case of collaborative filtering, when we're doing item-based, is basically just the relation between users who have watched similar things. And here I'm just adding a little bit more of color and complexity to the idea of similarity. But there are methods like the graph-based approaches and the ensembles that can help you find a good definition of similarity. Okay. I'm going to move on. Social recommendations. This is another novel trend, and it's different to anything that we've talked about before. The idea here is that we're going to be using explicit connections between users to define a notion of trust. And here, the relation between users is not based on co-occurrence of what they watch, what they rate, or anything like that. It's based on explicitly defining, I'm your friend, right? Is there a way that we can use that in order to infer recommendations? And the idea of trust is central to this, and the idea, you can interpret it as, if you're a person that has a high level of trust in this other person, whatever that the second person likes, you're going to like, right? So it's not trust in the traditional sense. It's trust in the sense of how much you can trust the recommendation from that user, right? Something that comes up always is that, I may trust this person very well on if that person recommends me clothes, but if not, if that person recommends me music. So there are notions of trust that can be topic specific and take that into account. So, okay, I'm going to skip through that. But the basic goal of many of these trust-based methods is that if you have some kind of graph like this where you have three different people that are connected, well, it's kind of simple to come up with a method in which you can say, okay, how much would the recommendation from A influence B, right? How much can, because there's a direct edge connecting A and B. So basically, you can use this number, however you come up with it, to infer how much B is going to trust A. A trickier question is when you don't have a direct connection, right? And you need to have that in your model. So if C needs a recommendation, and the only person that we know knows about that particular movie is A, how do we model the trust that C has on A if there's not a direct edge, right? So we need to find a way to propagate trust in a network. And that's what many of these models will do. So most of these models about trust and social recommendations, they're not so much concerned with the definition of trust between A and B, because that's something that you can come up, quote unquote, easily based on whatever proximity or based on any other definition that you want to come up with. But the idea is, once you have these two nodes connected, how do you propagate trust in the network to say, well, if that other node is not directly connected, how it should be influenced by that recommendation? So I'm not going to go into details, but I'm just putting them up here and putting some references at the end. These are some of the most well-known methods for modeling trust propagation in the network. So there's Advogado and Appleseed, Moltrust, and Golbik is very well known. She's actually probably the most well-known person working on trust-based recommendation, and her initial model was called Tidal Trust. So this is and I'll talk in a minute about that. This is an interesting and very different way of building recommendations to what we have traditionally been doing, right? In the context that we've usually been looking at collaborative filtering, which is co-occurrence of things that people buy. We've been looking at content-based recommendations and what the items are in reality. And this adds yet another different view on the recommendation problem. And it's interesting to... I think there's a lot to be done on this area still. I mean, even though there's been some work, being able to combine, especially the trust-based, with all the other more traditional methods is something that there's still a lot to be done and not that much work. Actually, I was talking to somebody yesterday about it. There's been a couple of papers lately. There was one last year where, in the context of a matrix factorization approach, the strength of the social connection in a social network was users' regularization factor in the matrix factorization computation. And that was an interesting paper because it was one of the few papers recently that has tried to add this notion of trust or social connection into the collaborative filtering approach, right? So I think this is going to be a growing area of research. Okay. As a side note, this is not even a method itself, but I thought I would mention it here. You can build recommendations based on demographic methods, right? And I think I mentioned it even when I was talking about the index. And the idea here is that you can use, just as you use content-based features on the items, you can use, quote-unquote, content-based features on the users, right? If you know where the user is from, the age group, and so on and so forth, you can build similarity functions between users and then use them as a way to recommend things. Or you can cluster users based on their demographic features. Okay. So basically, this concludes sort of like all the view that I did on the different kinds of individual recommendation methods. And just to give sort of a reminder, we started with the traditional collaborative filtering and content-based approaches. And today we've seen that one good way to think about recommendations is to think of it as a learning to rank approach. And we learn how to build a two-dimensional ranking problem. And we talk about point-wise and pair-wise and list-wise approaches to learning to rank. Then we made the problem a little bit more complicated by turning it from a two-dimensional problem to an n-dimensional and adding context. And we talked about tensor factorizations and about factorization machines. Then we went to see a couple of examples of how deep learning and neural networks are being used now to build recommendations. And finally, I've talked about the notion of similarity and graph-based approach to similarity as a way to recommend. And then yet adding another dimension to our recommendation, which comes from the social network approach and the strength of the social connections between the users. So with all those methods, and I've mentioned it a couple of times, an idea that comes up many times is that you want to combine them, right? And the easy, obvious thing is to build an ensemble. That's a great way to combine them. But there is some tradition in the recommendation literature of finding different ways to combine approaches in what's called hybrid ways, right? So hybrid recommendations come from this idea here, and this is a paper. I don't remember when this paper was out, but it's pretty old, meaning that it's been more than 10 years out. And the idea is pretty simple. If you have a collaborative filtering approach, you're going to get this kind of precision. And I don't remember the scale, what it was on, but the idea is, of course, the precision of the collaborative filtering approach is going to increase the more restaurants you have in common between people. Then if you have a content-based approach, it's going to be approximately flat. And initially, and that's why content-based approaches are good for cold start, is going to be superior to your collaborative filtering approach. But at some point, it's going to be surpassed by the collaborative filtering approach. But even better than any of the two is you can combine both of them. And if you combine both of them, you basically get the best of both worlds, right? Now you get the best performance and almost flat, and you get it both for the cold start case and also once you have more data points, right?
It looks like if I have 35 restaurants in common, I would drop the combination and I would just go with collaborative.
Theoretically, if two methods are uncorrelated and you combine them, even in an ensemble, right, it's going to be at least as good as the best of them, right? So the idea is that you don't need to, by combining them, if you do it right, you shouldn't lose anything over the best of the methods that you're combining, right? I know what you mean, that it looks that at some point this curve, but not necessarily. I mean, I think they might end up almost meeting, but you're probably always going to be getting something extra by adding that extra content. Okay, so this is a summary of the different methods for hybridizing recommendations. So I think I'm gonna be going over them quickly, but we have weighted, we have switching, we have mix, feature combination, cascade, feature augmentation, and meta level. So the weighted is probably the first one that you would think about, which is the ensemble way, right? So the idea is you have different combination, different recommendations systems that come from different places, like collaborative filtering, content-based, or any other approach, and you find a way to combine them and to build a linear ensemble, for example, and to determine what are the weights and how to combine them. You can think of the learning to rank approach that I was saying as a weighted hybrid method for recommendations, where the weights were determining the popularity and the rating. Now, as I say here, one of the limitations here is that you're assuming that the relative value between the weights is uniform across the different items, and that can be trickier, right? Because depending on the relation might not be linear, might depend on different things that are dependent on the item space or the subclass of items, whether they have more or less ratings, and so on. Okay, switching. In the case of switching, you have some sort of criteria in which you determine whether you're going to be using method A or B or method A, B, or C. And here the idea would be, well, if I have one particular item that doesn't have much data, I'll switch to content-based. If this item I know that has a lot of feedback, I'll use collaborative filtering. And you use that as a condition, right, to determine. And that's what actually the Daily Learner, which is a system, I don't know if it's up still, but it's a system that was using content and collaborative filtering and was using a switching technique in which you were determining which one of the two were using. And the idea is, in this case, it was using content-based recommendation and having a notion of confidence on how close those two items were based on a definition of similarity in the content domain. And if it didn't have enough confidence, then it would switch to the collaborative filtering approach. And of course, the switching condition can be done in whatever way you want. The mix approach, in the mix approach, you're basically just getting the output of the recommendation from both methods and then defining a way to mix the outputs and the items at the end. And you can think of this as a way to say, well, I'll just use most likely I'll just use collaborative filtering, but for new items that I don't have ratings for, I'll use a content-based approach, and then I'll find a ways to insert and to add them in a way to the output of the collaborative filtering. You can do feature combination. And that's another way to hybridize. And the idea here is, how do you combine collaborative information in some method or in a way? And you can do that if you use some sort of regression model, and you add collaborative data and content-based data as features to the rating or the ranking prediction component. Cascade. This is an interesting method in which you basically build a recommendation based on one particular model, and you use the output of that as the input of the next one. So you can do different things. Like, you could probably build sort of a ranking approach on the first part of your recommendation, and then take the top of the ranking and feed it to a new recommendation that is going to do a different thing, or the other way around. You could build a rating prediction recommendation based on collaborative filtering. Say, now I'm only going to take the items that have a predicted rating that is higher than 3, and I'm going to input that in a completely different recommendation system that is going to be implementing a learning to rank approach. And this is using the output of one as the input of the other. And feature augmentation, this is the idea basically that you use the prediction from one method as a feature to the other, to the next method. So here you're not inputting the output to the input of the other, but actually using it as a feature. And here the example that we were using before of using the rating prediction as an input to the two-dimensional ranking would be a good example of this. Okay, so I have 10 minutes to just give you a quick walk through some of these things, how we apply them to Netflix. And, oh, yeah, the one thing that I didn't mention yesterday, and I think I got a question after the class, is I talked about the RBM and the SVD, and I'm missing the pictures again here, and said, hey, we're using this in production. And some people ask me when I talk about those two things, they tell me, yeah, sure, but the final prize in 2009 had 104 different methods combined in an ensemble. What happened to the other 102? And the answer is, we are not using them in production. And there are a couple of reasons for that. And first reason is the difference between the delta in RMSE between the first year's progress prize and the final prize in 2009 was very small. So it was relatively small for the added complexity of going from two methods to 104. So it didn't really... All the complexity in engineering that we had to put in to add all these methods was not really not necessary. It wasn't really, we were not sure that was really worth it. The other reason is that we switched our focus at that same time, and we switched our focus from rating prediction, which was our problem in 2006, to many other things, which are our problem today. And one of the reasons reason that rating prediction was so important in 2006 and it's not so important today is the following. In 2006, Netflix was a DVD by mail company. So people, what they would do, by the way, anyone used Netflix DVD at one point? Anyone still using Netflix DVD? Oh, one person. good. So I use Netflix DVD, by the way, also. So so the idea when you use it, when you use a DVD is, or when you're using this kind of product, you put a lot of thought in what you put in your queue, because you're basically optimizing ahead, and you're thinking like, what do I want to watch on the weekend, and maybe with my family or whatnot. So you're really putting a lot of thought. You're thinking about what you want to watch. You're putting it in your queue. If it comes 2 days later and it turns out to be a bad movie, you're really disappointed, because you put thought, you waited 2 days, you get your movie, and like, oh, this is not what I wanted, right? So you have a lot of incentive to go back to the system and say, hey, this was awful. I'm going to rate it, so next time you recommend me something different. So there's a lot of incentive for people to give explicit feedback, and there's a lot of incentive of people to actually put thought into what they decide to watch. In the case of a product like what Netflix is mostly now, which is streaming, this has changed dramatically, right? So now you go in there, you hit play, you watch 5 minutes, I'll just go to something else. So the cost of switching to something different is very low, and the incentive to give feedback to the system is much less. So what we found during time is explicit feedback is now much less and much worse. And on the other hand, we have a ton now of implicit feedback, so we're not really so much interested anymore in doing rating prediction. Now we're interested in building things like ranking and so on, which are based on implicit feedback, right? And that's, by the way, that's a story that's repeated in many different companies, and you saw companies like YouTube going from a 5-scale rating system to just a thumbs up, thumbs down, because they were seeing a similar problem in which the quality of their ratings over time diminished and their rating prediction didn't make much sense. So this is what I'm saying here. We were DVD by mail. Now it's completely different. It's streaming. It's on many devices. Even giving feedback in some devices is kind of like annoying and clumsy. So I like a lot this quote, because I think it summarizes some of our feeling and some of the things we do. Is that Netflix, this was posted, I don't know, Huffington Post, saying Netflix, my least feature, knows you better than you know yourself because of algorithm. And that's really true. This is telling a real story. It is. So we had we have a list in Netflix where you can add the movies that you want to watch in the future. And a few months back, or maybe a year already, we allowed the users to actually sort those things by themselves, right? So basically you put things there, then you could move them around, put whatever you wanted first, and it was all up to the user. And we did a test in which we said, you know what, instead of letting the users do that, because users are lazy and they don't really know themselves, let's build algorithms that actually optimize for this particular feature, right? So we build an algorithm to sort the list, and guess what? The result of the test was positive, right? So this means that for whatever reason, the sorting, the automatic sorting that came out of the algorithm was much better, and people were watching much more from that list than before, when we would allow them to actually find their ideal sorting themselves, right? So this gives you an example, and it points to the fact that almost everything around Netflix is personalized and is really being recommended. And one of the reasons is because users, in general, will tell you, if I ask people, especially the people that are really into Netflix, they will say, oh, I want to do it myself. I want to really, and I'm really into it, and I rate a lot. But the reality is that most people want the algorithms to do the work for themselves. So this slide kind of summarizes the evolution of what Netflix recommendation has been over the last few years. We went from rating prediction, the Netflix price, to ranking optimization, which is something that we're doing, and I think we're doing pretty well already, to something different, which is what we're doing right now, and we're focusing a lot of effort, which is page optimization. And this is interesting because this is a different concept that there's not much in the literature. There's a lot of about ranking optimization, but page two-dimensional optimization, that's a different story. And here, you need to take into account attention models, browsing patterns of users, and you need to take into account things like diversity and so on. So it's a really tricky and interesting machine learning problem that we're working on right now. So ranking is what we do in this dimension, right? So this is the typical user interface for Netflix. You have rows, and each row has a ranking. And this ranking is not, obviously, there's a lot of thought put into this ranking, and it makes a lot of difference what kind of model we use to rank this, each of these rows. And we use learning to rank approaches like the one I described before, in which we use things like rating, popularity, and many other things. And, oh, here we go again. I'm missing, I think, for the last couple of slides, maybe I'm better off doing the PDF. Okay. Just to make sure I have the pictures. Ooh. Okay. Okay, so another thing we do is put a lot of effort in building algorithms that bring up support and explanation for the recommendation. If you look at this thing here, it has so much information and support for this recommendation. And what we put here makes a lot of difference. Even the image that we put here is going to make a lot of difference on whether you want to click on it or not, right? And here we have things like, well, this was based on your interest in this, this, and that. So we're giving you hints on what are the things that have brought up this recommendation. We even use the rating prediction. So the rating prediction that we were using before as our objective function now has become a feature, and it has become an explanation, right? So it's a completely different way to think about rating prediction. And of course, we have all this metadata and so on. And we even tell you that it's in your instant queue. This is now called the list, but it's the same thing. And this is also giving you a support for why you should want to watch this. We also have, so I talked about social recommendations and about trust-based. We do have that. So if you connect to Facebook, you will see what Facebook friends are watching, either as a combination, and here we use some of these approaches, or either individually. I'm going to have to start finishing now. For the rows, we use implicit, explicit, and hybrid taste tests. So we build them based on things you watched before, things you told us you like, or the combination of all of them. And concepts like freshness and diversity are something that we also need to take into account when we're building many of these things. And this is what builds this kind of very interesting roles where you have independent dramas featuring a strong female lead. These are genres that are made up of combinations of different tags, and we make them based on your taste preference. Here, for example, here we give you this role because you told us that you liked independent, and that's why you get independent, but also because you watch these two movies that have some of these tags here built into them, right? Okay, we have similarities. I talk about how to build similarity recommendations. We use that in some rows and in many different contexts. For example, when you add something to your list or when you search for something. And then we have the problem of page composition that I'm not going to go into. But we do have this idea of what's the attention of the user. And we've built using both click data and also eye tracking, we have models of attention of where the users, how they browse, and where their attention goes. And we have some information of that going into the model to be able to learn what matters and what doesn't matter. Okay. Oops, sorry, I'm going the other way around. Search recommendations, so we treat search as a problem of recommendation. If you search for something like Italy, you're not really searching for a movie that's called Italy. You're asking us to recommend you something related to Italy. If you search for Schindler's List that we don't have, we also want to recommend you something related to what you're searching for, right? So post-play is also another form of recommendation. You finish watching something, what you get afterwards. And all these are based on algorithms and ideas that I've described before. We even have on PS3 this new idea of gamification, or how to build recommendations into a game. And all the data we use, metadata, social, impressions, and this is a list of models that are currently in production. And that's it. I'm going to finish with some conclusions. And we've talked about many different topics. I just have a couple things to add here that, understanding data and users is a very important thing, not only for recommendations, but also for many other things like search, advertising, networks, and so on. Good data is important, but it's also important to be able to optimize the algorithm at the same time that you get data. And actually, let me see. I think my last piece of advice, because I see this happening many times, and it's about this relation between data and models. I've seen time and time again how people throw away ideas or throw away features because they're trying to optimize independently the feature space or the data and the model. And that's something that you need to be very careful with. So I'll give you two examples. If you're using a linear model or, say, a logistic regression, and you come up with this great idea of like, oh, I'm going to add this feature, but that feature turns out to be non-linear or non-linearly dependent with the output of the logistic regression, it might turn out that your logistic regression is not able to learn it or not able to learn it in a significant way that you're optimizing or you're improving your metrics, right? So what happens there, people have this simple model, they try this new feature, and they say, oh, it doesn't work, forget it. And they forget about that feature as something that it's not adding any value. The other way around, you've worked for some time and you have your super optimized linear regression with a number of features, and you say, you know what, let's try a super smart model now and let's feed all these features into our random forest. It turns out that it doesn't work, or it doesn't add anything significant to your model. What happened there is that you had optimized your feature so much for a linear model that a nonlinear model is not going to add anything to it. So what's the solution here? The solution is you always need to be careful about optimizing both things at the same time. If you're optimizing your features, optimize your model, and the other way around. If you optimize your model, make sure you add features that your new model is going to be able to learn from. And with that, I think I'm over time, so I'm going to just go. You have all the references are going to be on the slide, so I put a bunch of references here and even online resources where you can learn more about recommendation systems. Okay, thank you very much.